Hello, everybody. Today I'm going to talk to you all about sound on film sets or television sets, how it's used in these film sets, what the different microphones do, and how to behave when you are mic'd up on set. And I will talk a little bit about stage sound as well a little later on in the video. But let's get started after the bump. Hello friends, I'm Doug Fall, your augmented actor. If you would like to augment your acting career with tips, tactics, and tech, hit that subscribe button and you'll be well on your way. So I recently did a short film shoot, one of many that I've done in the past. In this one, I had the pleasure of playing a cowboy mechanic character. It was quite fun.
So we're shooting at a small craft airplane hangar landing strip out in Arlington, Washington. See behind me, there's lots of old and new planes grounded, and they're even doing some airplane shots in the video, in the movie that we're shooting, so that's cool. And it's right next to a restaurant called Ellie's. It's really fun to be on a film set.
And our sound guy was really pleasant to work with. And I just thought, you know, this would be a time to maybe discuss sound on film sets. In traditional film and television, there are two main ways that sound is captured. And they are the boom mic, which is also called a shotgun mic. And this is the thing you might see a sound tech holding over your head or under the table, popping up from down below. And that is a very focused, narrow field of audio recording. It's also usually the primary source of audio for the audio designer and audio editor because it gets the cleanest quality sound. Depending on the shot, the boom mic might not always be able to get close enough to record a good quality sound. And it can only aim at one person at a time. So like in a big group scene, only one person's audio is going to be in focus at any given moment. And so the backup for that is a lapel mic or a body mic. And these are little wired mic, usually pinned to your lapel. You might see them in an interview coming on somebody's tie or in their collar or something like that. But for film, these mics need to be hidden because people don't have mics on in real life. So the lavalier mics record one person's audio pretty well, but they do have some flaws. Often they are underneath clothing, so you'll get the rustling of clothes. They also might pick up a person's heartbeat or their sniffs and their coughs and things like that. Sometimes the audio is messy. You give the sound designer a boom track and the individual lav mic tracks, and then they can mix the best takes together. And if neither the boom audio or the lav audio is clean, the sound designer might opt to bring in the actor after the fact and do what is called an ADR session. It's also called looping or dubbing. ADR stands for automated dialogue replacement. And that's a process where the actor repeats the lines synced up to the action on camera, often with an audio track of the poor quality audio playing as a reference. But let's get back to lav mics for a second. A lav mic is placed on your body usually or on your clothing and it's hidden. If you look at some films, you might see somebody usually wearing a t-shirt and you'll see like a little dot protruding out of their t-shirt. That's usually a lav mic. They're often taped to the inside of your shirt or onto your chest. They might go under your collar somewhere, inside your collar. They're just gonna be just where they can be out of sight, but still pick up a clean audio signal. So there are a couple things that you should be aware of when you're wearing a lavalier mic, especially if it's under your clothes, is that clothes rustling is a large audio interference problem. The more you can consciously not rustle your clothes while you're speaking, the better and cleaner your audio take will be. Now, that's not always possible given the direction that you're supposed to be following. Also, if you're outside and the wind is blowing, this can be a big factor. It's an audio designer's nightmare is wind. They can put a little foam thing around the tip of the lav mic to block out the wind. That works a little bit, but one of the best ways to block out the wind is to have your back toward the direction of the wind so that your mic is kind of shielded from the gust of the wind. Now, also, that's not always possible depending on the way the shot is blocked, but just keep it in mind. Now, if your lav mic is on one side, kind of off center, you want to be conscious of the direction in which you deliver your lines and try not to turn your head the opposite direction too much or go toward the mic too much as well. Usually they'll try to center the mic so that the audio is balanced, but just be aware of where your mic is. And also be aware that you don't hit your mic accidentally. When the audio person has their headset on, they can hear pretty much everything you're saying. So you never want to gossip, and you want to keep your conversations minimal at best. And you don't want to talk very loudly either. You never want to shout across the room when the person has their headset on. You can sometimes joke with the audio tech by saying things into your chest and they can hear you across the room. That's kind of fun to do, but you don't want to distract them from their job, and you don't want to be listed as a joker either. Couple etiquette things. If you're gonna cough or sneeze, try to warn the audio person. Just say, hey, I'm about ready to sneeze, and then that will give them a chance to turn the volume down or take their headset off, or at least be prepared for it. And if you can't avoid it, cover the mic gently with your hand, turn your head, and cough outside the mic range. If you're wearing a mic, you want to keep your sniffles and your your clearing of throats and little sounds like that to a minimum as well. And if you need to go to the bathroom, it's often a good idea to let the sound tech know that you need to go to the bathroom, because, you know, they might inadvertently listen to you go to the bathroom. If your microphone happens to fall from where it is taped or pinned, always let the sound tech put it back. It's their job to do that, and they get a little bit particular about who touches their microphone. These are very expensive pieces of equipment. The cord itself can run several hundred dollars sometimes, so you want to make sure that you're treating that with utmost respect. And that includes not ever leaving set with a microphone on. Because these are expensive pieces of equipment, the sound tech will often only have a few of these microphones on them, and each set might require that a different actor has a different microphone. So if you leave set and go somewhere with this microphone on, and they can't find you, they may need that for another actor, and you've just cost them a lot of time and stress. A lav mic is a corded microphone that goes down to a little box that is a transmitter to the sound tech's equipment. And that little box has to be clipped onto your belt or inside your pants. Sometimes they'll put a little mic belt on your waist that you can put that in a little pocket. When that is put in there, you must leave it in there, and you must never touch the dials. You must never turn it off or on. That is not yours to touch. When you're about ready to shoot, you will test your audio levels, and that means that you want to deliver the lines that you're actually delivering in the scene at the intensity level and the volume level that you will deliver them. So that if you have some very soft lines, they want to be able to make sure that they get those lines picked up. And if you have some screaming lines suddenly, they want to be able to know where those lines fall and be able to turn the volume down or adjust it as needed. So give them your full performance, as at least in terms of volume, when you're doing a test. A sound tech in their spare time, if they ever have any, might also want to have you run the scene so that they can follow you properly with the boom mic, and it's always courteous to give them that little chance to rehearse with you. They have to have the job of keeping that boom mic out of the shot and their own body out of the shot while still getting the sound, so they need to know where the lines fall and where your action is taking place. When it's time to put the microphone on or take the microphone off, always follow the instructions of the person who's putting it on you. If they want you to help them feed the cord up or take the cord out, that's great. Go ahead and help them. Just be careful. And if not, let them do it. Let them do all the work, all the placement, and all the taping. And now, I promised you a little bit about stage microphones. Now on stage, you might use a handheld mic or a lavalier mic that is clipped to your ear or stuck in your wig. Or through your part of your hair, something like that. It's usually taped right there. A lot of shows won't use microphones depending on the size of the theater and how much music is being played during the show or sound effects. If you're in a musical, you're bound to be wearing a microphone. The same rules apply. Don't wear it outside of the theater. Always be aware that you could be recorded and that conversations off stage should not be happening because your mic might be live. Good sound designers will take the volume down as soon as you finish speaking or as soon as you exit the stage, but not always. And there are occasions when somebody, an actor, will leave and go out and go to the bathroom and talk smack about the show, and that will be broadcast to the audience. Even if it's just a few moments, it's really embarrassing. Try not to talk for like 10 seconds after you leave the stage. On stage, you often can take your own microphone off or put your own microphone on. But when you remove a microphone, do not coil the cord around the pack. Do not coil the cord up at all. That is stress on the cord and it can damage it. If you don't know what you're doing, always just hand the microphone to whoever's doing the sound and let them coil it up, let them store it the way they want it stored. Now you know all about how to be a professional when it comes to sound on set and on stage. How about that? If you want to have some more useful advice, click on this video up here and I will show you something new. Otherwise, click on this playlist down here and you'll see some other cool videos. Talk to you next time.